Hello everybody, my name is Tjeerd Datema. I work at Datos and I've been invited by Fondation Milieu to do a webcast focusing on the question, how do we define quality? What is the definition of quality? I will be talking about that quality is meeting customer requirements. When you talk about quality, you talk about customer requirements. And I'm going to be talking about quality standards and that customer requirements are represented by quality standards. I'll be talking about ISO 15189, the quality standard for medical laboratories, and that complying with this quality standard means implementing a quality management system. And I will also give you a bit of background information on quality management systems, that they consist of 12 quality system elements or essentials. That all affect all aspects of the laboratory or the laboratory system. So the objectives of this webcast are to define quality, to introduce the quality standards and the ISO 15189 for medical laboratories, to discuss the structure of the quality management system complying with ISO 15189 requirements, to discuss the purpose and also the result of implementing a quality management system, and also to present a bit about the history or the evolution of quality management. First, a bit of background information about myself. As I said, I work at Datos. This is an organization based in the Netherlands that focuses on laboratory strengthening worldwide, and primarily in low and middle income countries. And our activities focus actually on all levels of laboratory strengthening. So from the level of assisting national governments or national laboratory working groups with developing national laboratory policies and strategic plans. So really to strengthen the whole laboratory system in the country, up to the level of assisting individual laboratories implementing a quality management system and everything in between. So designing an assessment of laboratory networks and systems, supporting laboratories through training, assessments or conducting audits, advising and mentoring on quality management, management leadership and actually also on biorisk management, and designing and maintaining also implementing tools for laboratory strengthening. And all employees of our organization actually have an academical background, and we also like to do some research to contribute to the evidence base underlying laboratory strengthening activities. So when I talk about quality, or when I start to talk about quality or quality management, I always start with this question. Can you accept in daily life a 99% level of quality, 99% quality? And actually, people always tend to respond positively to this question initially. But when you turn it around, you say you accept 1% of failure. And maybe you don't want to accept 1% of failure always. For example, in the Netherlands, where I come from, with 1% of failure, 1% of non-quality, you accept every day 10,000 parcels lost by the postal services, 13 or even 14 bad landings or takeoffs from Amsterdam Airport, the international airport, and 4 to 5 newborns falling from midwives' hands, just to give you a couple of examples. So 1% of non-quality is not really acceptable when you talk about these kind of things. Now, when you look at poor quality, there are also costs associated. Costs associated with non-quality are visible, but there are also many invisible costs. For example, poor utilization, prolonged illness, wrong diagnosis. This is really when you look at healthcare, at laboratories. Wrong treatment, repeated OPD visits, death even. And of course, the invisible costs, frustrated patients, wasted health worker time, wasted laboratory tests, low health worker morale, loss of community trust, unnecessary illness, late presentations, wasted patient time, wasted medications, well, I can go on and on. And this is really cost and also other types of resources that are wasted when non-quality or poor quality is provided. Now, medical laboratories are there to provide reliable results, to improve the decision-making capacity of clinicians and health workers, as well as public health authorities. Now, the consequences of poor quality also in the medical laboratory are serious. Inappropriate treatment, investigations and responses. Sorry, I need to clear my throat a bit. So, what you can say is that, yes, quality costs money, but non-quality costs a fortune. Now, let's get back to the question of this webcast. What is quality? How do we define quality? Now, to define quality, we have to focus on the customer. And I always try to get a definition of quality through an exercise. Because, you know, quality is really difficult to define when you just ask people this question. I mean, what is quality? What are quality shoes, for example? Well, something that is good, something that is nice or beautiful. But that is not really graspable. So let's do it in another way. Let me ask you, when you go to a restaurant, what are your requirements to this restaurant? So imagine you have a dinner, you are going for a dinner at a restaurant. What are your requirements to have a good dinner or a quality dinner? Now, and then you can think of all kinds of things. The restaurant should be hygienic, the food should be well prepared, should be big variation, there should be a nice ambience, friendly staff, a big parking lot maybe, accommodation to house many different people, many staff members. Now, and if you have a list of all these requirements and all these requirements are met, what is then your opinion about the quality of this restaurant? And then you can say, yes, this restaurant is of high quality. It met all my requirements. Now, what you can deduct from this is the definition of quality in the most simplest form is quality is meeting customer requirements. If you look at the definition of the International Organization for Standardization of Quality, you can say quality is the degree to which a set of inherent characteristics of an object fulfills customer requirements. Well, this is a very fancy way of defining quality, but it actually comes down to the same thing. Quality is meeting customer requirements. We produce an object or we produce a service in the case of a laboratory. And when this object or service meets our customer requirements, we can say that the quality is good. So for a restaurant to know how to provide quality services and quality food, the restaurant must know the requirements of its customers and also meet them, of course. The thing with customer requirements is that they can vary. They can vary from time to time, from situation to situation, context to context. For example, are your requirements to a restaurant the same where you go for dinner as where you go for lunch? Probably not. So there needs to be a bit of standardization of customer requirements to make them applicable to all types of situations. Now, and standardized or generic customer requirements are called quality standards. And quality standards are the same, should be the same for all restaurants. They reflect customer requirements and they are applicable to all settings or all contexts. So regardless whether you go for lunch, a quick lunch, or a very extensive dinner, whether you go for a business lunch, or whether you go for a wedding dinner, whether you go for a family dinner, or even a romantic dinner for two. So quality standards represent customer requirements. A standard is a document that provides requirements, specifications, guidelines, or characteristics that can be used to consistently ensure that materials, products, processes, and services are fit for purpose. This is the accepted definition of a quality standard. It's a document with requirements to provide quality services or quality products. Now, when an organization wants to provide quality services or quality products, it obviously needs to comply with quality standards. Now, let's get to the medical laboratory. Now, we have been talking about the restaurant. Let's now start talking about the medical laboratory. The quality standard for medical laboratories is ISO 15189. This is a standard for quality and competence in medical laboratories. It was published in 2012, or the latest version was published in 2012. And it's based on ISO 9001. And I will talk more about this later in this webcast. When you completely comply with the requirements of this quality standard as a laboratory, you will be accredited, or you can become accredited if so desired. Let's have a look at some of the causes of poor quality in the laboratory. Well, poor quality in the laboratory, in a medical laboratory, can be caused by, for example, poor sample control, poor result verification, poor quality control or no quality control or assessment, the use of non-validated tests, time pressure, poor workload management, understaffing or inadequate attention to detail. Now, when you look at these possible causes, you see that they are at different places in the laboratory process or in the laboratory system. For example, they can be related to the way you manage the testing process, or the pre-analytical process in the case of poor sample control. It can also be related to the way you organize the laboratory, or the way personnel is managed, with time pressures and poor workload management and understaffing are related to the way the laboratory is organized, how many staff there are, what tasks they have. Now, when you want to improve the quality of the laboratory, it means also that you have to make sure that all these elements, all these possible causes are addressed, or all the areas in the laboratory that may cause poor quality are improved. And this is exactly what a quality management system does. A quality management system can be divided in 12 different elements, which we call quality system essentials. Here I have an overview, a framework. We have organization, personnel management, equipment management, purchasing and inventory, process control, information management, documents and records management, occurrence management, assessment, process improvement. There's also customer service, and a quality management system also addresses the facilities and the safety practices in the laboratory. So you see that it not only addresses the testing process of the laboratory, but it really addresses the whole laboratory, all aspects or all areas of the laboratory. Now, when we redivide these elements a bit, we have here a category of personnel, equipment purchasing and inventory, facility safety. Here we put the process control, information management and documents and records. And here we put non-conformity management, customer service, assessment and continual improvement, and on top of everything, the organization. Now, when you have a good look at this, you can see that these are all resources. And these elements are related to the work in the laboratory, the actual testing process. And these elements here are related to evaluation of our work and improvement of our work. In other words, plan, do, check, act. These are the resources to plan the work. Here you do the work, and here you check and act the work. So with these elements, you plan the work, here you do the work, and these elements make sure you check the work, and if you find some points for improvement, you act upon it. And by that, you have the plan, do, check, act cycle, which I also wanted to introduce to you, which is also called the Deming cycle. It's a very famous cycle used in many different types of organizations to really make sure that the work is done in a proper way. And this cycle is also really the basis of a quality management system, Plan, Do, Check, Act, or PDCA. Now, all quality system essentials contribute to assuring quality of the primary laboratory process. On this slide, I've shown the primary laboratory process in 10 different steps: sample control, transport and reception, sample registration, sample preparation, sample processing, examination, recording, reporting, and waste disposal and archiving as the last two steps. And this is really can be divided in the pre-analytical, the analytical, and the post-analytical phase. And when you look at the quality system essentials, they really address all these different steps. So the quality management system, all this quality system essentials work together to make sure that the quality of the primary laboratory process is continuously controlled and assured. Now, let's talk about some of the benefits of a quality management system. Quality management system really consistently, let's talk about the benefits of a quality management system. A quality management system is there to consistently help you achieve customer requirements, to minimize errors, waste, and complaints, improve efficiency. It reduces negative impact on our customers, communication breakdowns, and also improves safety and morale. And of course, it standardizes all the work to make sure that it's always done in a proper way. It also ensures adequacy of resources and adequate use of resources. Building improvement tools to continuously improve the work in the laboratory, facilitates changes and easier problem solving, and improves self-confidence of the laboratory. And also the confidence of the customers, the patients and the doctors of the laboratory. And basically it's also required for the survival of certain laboratories. And the quality management system really helps to, or is really the foundation to ensure quality of laboratory services. It really supports the whole primary laboratory process in assuring the quality of laboratory services. So let me tell you a bit about the history of quality management, because it's not new. It has been around for a very long time. For example, if you look at the pyramids in Egypt, they have been built with a very high level of precision. They're huge buildings, and of course you needed to have some quality management practices to ensure that these buildings were steady enough and could be built. Quality management can also be seen already in the industrial revolution. You see the use of interchangeable parts. People thought that, well, if we have interchangeable parts in our machinery, we ensure the continuity of our production processes. Also, statistical tools were used for quality control during World War II. And I really like this example. In the Netherlands, there were guilds. Guilds were groups or associations of certain craftsmen, people doing a certain profession. Here we have a painting of the Guild of the Dutch Masters. And these guilds, they checked the quality of, in this case, paintings being produced, to assure that they met a certain level of quality. And if they didn't meet that level of quality, if they didn't meet their criteria, these paintings were not allowed to be sold. So this is really already a form of quality control being practiced in the Middle Ages. Now, when we look a bit at the more recent history, there were a couple of quality management gurus, you can say, that I want to introduce to you. We have Walter A. Seward and William Edward Deming. And these two gentlemen focused on statistical quality control, statistical calculations around quality controls and process controls. And actually, Walter A. Seward and William Edward Deming, they were the founding fathers of the Plan-Do-Check Act cycle, or the Plan-Do-Study Act cycle, as Mr. Deming preferred, because studying implies a higher level of scrutiny than checking. But still, the Plan-Do-Check Act cycle is known as the PDCA cycle nowadays, better than the Plan-Do-Study Act cycle. Armand Feigenbaum, he came up with the principles of total quality control, and this is really the foundation of the nowadays total quality management. And then we have Phil Crosby, who said the definition of quality is conformance to requirements. Requirements meaning both the product and the customer requirements. So here he already came up with that customer requirements are important to look at when you want to implement quality management. And he said also the system for quality is prevention. To assure quality, you have to prevent failures. And the performance standards is zero defects relative to the requirements. And the measurement of quality is the price of a non-conformance or non-conformances. a bit about quality standards. When you look at the evolution of quality standards, you can see that there were a couple of industries that started with using or making quality standards, and these were the US military industry, the Japanese manufacturing industry, and the US aeronautics and space program. These organizations or these this industry started to make quality standards around the 50s and 60s. Namely, in 1959, the US military industry came up with the MIL-Q9858A standard, and this is a quality standard for military procurement. Now, in 1962, NASA came up with a quality standard also, and also with the requirements for suppliers. In 1965, NATO came up also with specifications for procurement of equipment. And the philosophy was that if we make sure that the things that we buy, the supplies and the equipment that we buy is of a good quality, we ourselves are also able to provide a good quality or to produce a good quality product. Now, in 1979, the BS-5750 was created, and this is actually a series of standards for use by manufacturing companies, and these are generic requirements to quality management systems. And in 1988, the ISO, the International Organization for Standardization, adopted the BS-5750 standard without any changes and published it globally under the name or code ISO 9000. And this later evolved into ISO 9001. And the view of this effort was to create an international definition of the necessary characteristics of a quality system for all businesses, regardless of industry. So the ISO 9001 standard is applicable to all types of businesses. It's not specifically for laboratories or not specifically for production companies. No, you can apply it everywhere. By the way, the abbreviation or ISO is not really abbreviation of International Standards Organization. It's called the International Organization for Standardization, and ISO stands for ISOS, which is the Greek word for equal, which they imply standardization with. Now let's have a look at how ISO 15189 was created. First there was the ISO 9001. And based on the ISO 9001, the ISO 17025 was developed, and this was in 1999, it was published. And this is standard for test and calibration laboratories. And from the ISO 17025, the ISO 15189 for medical laboratories was developed. And that was first published in 2003. So ISO 15189 is based on both ISO 9001 and ISO 17025. Nowadays there are many different models of quality management. There's a total quality management model, the EFQM model, excellence model. There's a lean system, Six Sigma, just to mention a couple. And these to really focus on minimizing or eliminating any unnecessary processes to really ensure a quality product and also an effective or efficient production process. But in essence, all these different models are the same thing. They refer to the systematic implementation of policies, methods, and procedures to ensure that goods and services are produced with appropriate levels of quality and to meet the needs of the customers, which is really the definition of quality management. Now, to summarize a bit, quality management. In quality management, you say what you do what you say, you do it state of the art, which means that you do it professionally. You standardize, and you standardize some more, and you standardize some more. And you measure and monitor those things that are important to your customer to really ensure that the quality standards are met. You focus on the process and you assess continuously this process, whether it goes well. So we already said the definition of quality is ensuring that laboratory services meet customer requirements or customer needs. Now, for the medical laboratory, this means the right test results at the right time, on the right specimen from the right patient with result interpretation based on correct reference data and at the right price. So simply said, doing the right things right. So to remember, to summarize this webcast, quality is the degree to which a set of inherent characteristics of an object fulfills customer requirements. That is the definition of quality. Quality is meeting customer needs, customer requirements. Customer requirements are represented by quality standards, and quality standard for medical laboratory is ISO 15189. And complying with the requirements of ISO 15189 means implementing a quality management system. A quality management system consists of 12 essentials, quality system essentials, which affect all aspects of the laboratory. And they all contribute to controlling and assuring the quality of the primary laboratory process. And again, for the laboratory, quality is the right test result at the right time on the right specimen from the right patient with result interpretation based on correct reference data and at the right price. And that means doing the right things right, providing quality. So I hope you enjoyed this webcast, and I wish you good luck with implementing a quality management system yourself. Thank you.